We're going to turn to 1 Corinthians, chapter number 12 tonight, 1 Corinthians 12. And then we'll get into 1 Corinthians 13. And for some, if you are very familiar with 1 Corinthians 13, you know what this chapter is all about. But as always, I ask that when we come to a passage that might be familiar to you, that you just ask the Lord to give you again, afresh, anew, what you need tonight. And so let's go to the Lord in prayer before we get into the message tonight. Heavenly Father, I do pray that you will speak to our hearts. Lord, thank you for your people here, your faithful people. Bless them, Lord. Put a hedge about them and give us what we need from your word. Lord, we are needy people, and you know the burdens, the heartaches, the struggles each family faces. So I'm asking you tonight, meet the needs that only you can meet. And we'll give you the credit and the praise. Help us to yield to you whatever you show to us tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. The title of the message is this, A More Excellent Way. If you read 1 Corinthians 12, he's talking all about gifts that are given to the church, how that there are different gifts that each of us have, and those gifts are given to profit the body of Christ, to advance the gospel of Jesus Christ. And he talks about many of those gifts. I'm not going to spend time looking at the gifts tonight. But if you go to 1 Corinthians 12, verse 27, notice he says, Now ye are the body of Christ, and members in particular. And again, chapter 12 talked about how all the members are different, but they're all necessary. Your eye is not a hand or an ear, but they're all important. They're all necessary. And that's why it's so important for us to appreciate what other members of the body of Christ bring to the body. Ye are the body of Christ, and members in particular, and God hath set some in the church, first apostles, secondarily, prophets, thirdly, teachers, after that, miracles, then gifts of healings, helps, governments, diversities of tongues. Are all apostles, are all prophets, are all teachers, are all workers of miracles? Have all the gifts of healing? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret? And the answer to that, all those questions is no. Each was given a different gift, and I want to remind you that many of these gifts were given, they were sign gifts. They were given to verify the newly written word of God. So the Old Testament was in existence, but the New Testament was not. And so God used the apostles to give us the New Testament. How would you know what these men were saying was the truth of God? Well, God gave them the ability to perform miracles. Mark 16 says that God worked with them, confirming the word with signs following. So those gifts were given to confirm the word of God. With that in mind, he says, do all have these gifts? No, everyone has different gifts. Notice what he says in verse 31. He says, but covet earnestly the best gifts. And if you read later on in chapter 14, he actually says what the best gifts are. But now he's going to speak about something that's not a gift at all, but it's something that we all need to have, and we all need to be operating under this power. He says, covet earnestly the best gifts, and yet show I unto you a more excellent way. He said, there's all these gifts, and they're wonderful, and God's given each of us a gift to bring to the body of Christ, but there's something even better than the gifts that we have. There's something better. He said, I'm going to show you a more excellent way. Chapter 13, verse 1, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, and have not charity, I am become as sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. What is the more excellent way? The more excellent way is the way of charity. Now again, this may not sound as exciting as some other things like, you know, end times or the power of God or soul winning or to me, you know, those topics excite me. They do. I'm excited about all the Word of God, but this topic may not seem that exciting, but the truth is this, without charity, as God's Word says, we are nothing. And I want you to notice this, the word charity, it appears 27 times in the Bible, they're all in the New Testament. It appears 8 times in this chapter we're about to read. The word charitably appears 1 time, Romans 14. The first mention of the word charity says that charity edifieth, that means it builds up. Charity, sometimes when people think of charity, they think of, charity, but that's not the charity I'm talking about tonight. Or they think of giving to the poor. But you'll see that's not charity either. That's not what the Bible's talking about, giving to the poor. That's a good thing to do. But that's not what charity is. In fact, when we think of charity, think of this verse, for God so, what's the next word? Loved. It's the same exact meaning. It's a love that is altruistic, meaning it's a love that is focused on the receiver of the love. It's a love that is pure. It's a love that is not selfish. It's a love completely focused on others. It's a love without any strings attached. It's a love without any manipulation. You know, we have to be careful. Some of the things we do in the name of love, if we're not careful, all we're trying to do is get others to respond a certain way to us, and that's not real love. Real love is you do it purely for the benefit of the other person. That's what real love is. If you give to get, that's not pure love. If you give compliment in hopes of getting a compliment, that's not pure love. The kind of love we're talking about here is the kind of love that God has shown to the world. Again, a love without strings attached, a love without conditions. I want you to see, number one, the necessity of charity, how important charity, love without strings attached, love that's God's kind of love, the necessity of charity. Notice verse 1, he says, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels and have not charity, I am become as sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. What's he saying? He said, if I don't have charity, even if I have the ability to speak with the tongues of men and of angels and I don't have charity, I'm just an irritating noise. That's it. You know, in order to speak into someone's life, you have to earn that right. You do. If you just give advice out left and right without earning that right, that advice will seldom be heeded. Spiritual gifts, notice, without charity are nothing. Look at verse 2. In fact, if you read in chapter 14, he says the greatest gift to covet is the gift of prophecy, which is preaching. It's forthtelling the word of God. But notice what he says, verse 2. He says, and though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, even if I can preach and I totally understand every verse in the Bible and I can tell you exactly what it means, I understand all mysteries, all knowledge. Verse 2, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains. Is that important to have faith? It is important. In fact, the Bible says without faith, it is what? It is impossible to please God. So faith is important. And what is faith? It's taking God at his word. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. It's the evidence of things not seen. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is and that he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. So we're not saying faith isn't important. It's extremely important to the Christian life. But notice what he's saying. Even if you have the best gift, which is prophecy, and you understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and you have all faith so that you could remove mountains, notice he says, and have not charity. I am, what is the next word? I'm nothing. So what's the necessity of charity? Spiritual gifts without charity are nothing. They're nothing. Notice next what he says, verse 3, and notice this, sacrifice without charity is nothing. So I give of myself. That's wonderful. We should. But you can give without loving. You can. You can't love without giving, but you can give without loving. Sacrifice without charity is nothing. Notice what he says, verse 3, and though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, and have not charity, it profiteth me, what's the next word? Nothing. Sacrifice for other people without charity is nothing. Sometimes, and this is a mistake, someone will do something for someone else, and then they'll remind them of what they've done for them. You remember I did this for you? Well, that's not altruistic. That's not charity. That's not God's kind of love. That's manipulation. That's saying, hey, I did this for you. Now you're beholden to me. Sacrifice without charity is nothing. In fact, Proverbs 15:17, it says this, better is a dinner of herbs. Now think through that for a minute. A dinner of herbs. How many of you had some lunch today? How many of you had a lunch of herbs? That was it. That's not very much. If tonight you go home and say, honey, what's for dinner? Herbs. You know. No thank you. You know. But notice it says, better is a dinner of herbs where love is than a stalled ox, the very finest steak you could have, and hatred therewith. By the way, what does that tell us? That tells us you can't buy love. You can't buy love. Love is not bought. You can give love, but you can't buy love. And by the way, having more stuff is not what's going to make you happy. What will make you happier in your home is real love. Real love. Sacrifice without charity is nothing. Sacrifice for other people. How about sacrifice for God? Say, but I sacrifice. I give of myself in service to the Lord. Do you know what God wants? He doesn't want our sacrifice. What does he want? Somebody tell me. He wants our obedience. You know, you can't be a second-mile Christian until you're a first-mile Christian. Remember when Saul disobeyed the Lord, what did Samuel say? Samuel said, hath the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in, what's the next word? Obeying the voice of the Lord. Behold to, what's the next word? Anybody know? Obey is better than sacrifice. And to hearken, that means to listen to the Lord, than the fat of rams. Sacrifice without charity, sacrifice without love is nothing. Sacrifice for other people, sacrifice for God without love is nothing. How do we show our love to God? What did Jesus say? John 14:15. If ye love me, do what? Keep my commandments. We show God our love by our obedience. 1 John 2:3 says, hereby we do know that we know him if we keep his commandments. He that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoso keepeth his word, in him verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we that we are in him. He that saith he abideth in him ought himself also so to walk, even as he, Jesus, walked. The necessity of charity is that even with our spiritual gifts, if we don't have charity, we're nothing. And even if we sacrifice everything we have, including our own bodies, but we don't have charity, whether that sacrifice be for people or for God, if we do it without charity, it profits nothing. Nothing. What a waste to give your body to be burned and everything you own, and yet it profits nothing. What a waste. Number two, I want you to see the characteristics of charity. Here's a working definition. What does charity look like? Say, I don't know, am I a loving person or not? Am I filled with charity? Well, ask yourself, do these traits permeate your being? The characteristics of charity. And by the way, the Bible says that charity is the pinnacle of spiritual maturity. It's the pinnacle. It means if you want to be the most like Christ, then what's the pinnacle? It's charity. It's that altruistic love that has no strings attached. What are the characteristics of charity? Notice verse 4. Explains it here. Charity suffereth long and is kind. Notice the conjunction and. Those two go together. Charity suffereth long and is kind. It suffers, but it's still kind while it's suffering. Let me say this, and again, I've told you before, when I say these things, God always preaches these messages to me first, always. Stop keeping score of the things that have been done against you. Stop keeping score. Say, that person's hurt me. I don't doubt that. That person's done me wrong. I don't doubt that. But stop keeping score. Stop reciting all of the wrongs that have been done against you. If you want to review anything, review this. Review the many sins God has forgiven you of. If you want to review anything and keep score, try to keep score, think of all the mercy and grace that's been poured out upon your life from God. You know, you remember that story of the servant who had embezzled funds from his boss? You read that story, there's only one way he could be in debt to his boss that way. It's by embezzling funds. It literally was like 85,000 years worth of salary. I mean, how do you get in debt that much? By stealing. That's what he had done. And his Lord said, pay your debt. He couldn't pay his debt. He said, have mercy on me, and I'll pay thee all. Was that true? Could he pay him all? No, of course he couldn't. He could never pay the debt. But what did he do? He begged his Lord and said, please forgive me the debt. Because you're merciful, because you're gracious, because you're righteous. And what did his Lord do? He forgave him the debt. You know, I have a debt I could never pay. I deserve hell. I deserve hell. Could never pay that. But Jesus took my place. paid the full debt. It's paid in full. When the Bible says Jesus is the propitiation for our sins, that means he satisfied our debt. He satisfied God's wrath on sin. It's paid in full. That same servant who had been forgiven of all, he went out and found another servant. Now, when I first read that story years ago, I just thought, well, his fellow servant didn't owe him that much. But actually, if you really study it out, his fellow servant owed him about 4 months' worth of salary. That's quite a bit. How many of you'd be happy to get a check for 4 months' worth of your salary tomorrow? That's a lot of money. His fellow servant owed him 4 months' worth of salary, and his fellow servant came to him and said, have mercy on me, have patience with me, and I'll pay thee all. Is that possible? Could he have paid him back? Yeah, he could have over time. 4 months, but take a long time, but he could do it. But what did this servant who had been forgiven all do? He took him by the throat. He said, pay me that thou owest, and he cast him into the debtor's prison. He said, you're not coming out till you've paid me everything. And when his Lord heard of it, what did he do? He changed the sentence and threw that servant into the prison. You know, the point is this, that yes, there may be somebody who has hurt you and done you wrong, but God has forgiven us far more than what anybody else has ever done to us, than what anybody else has ever said about us. Charity, notice, charity suffereth long and is kind. Stop keeping score. Stop reciting all the wrongs that have been done against you. Proverbs 10:12 says, hatred stirreth up strifes, but love covereth all sins. Proverbs 17:9 says, he that covereth a transgression seeketh love, but he that repeateth a matter separateth very friends, even good friends. If you keep picking and bringing up things from the past, you're going to separate even good friends. 1 Peter 4:8 says, above all things, have fervent charity among yourselves, for charity shall cover the multitude of sins. Notice the first characteristic of charity is that it's long-suffering and it's kind. The second characteristic of charity, notice, charity suffereth long and is kind. Next, charity envieth not. It envieth not. Remember in the Bible, jealousy is a good thing, envy sin. Jealousy is extremely and passionately wanting something that belongs to you. Envy is when you want something that belongs to somebody else. It's an attitude towards someone else because they have something you want. Charity envieth not. You know, the Bible says in Romans 12:15, rejoice with them that do what? That do rejoice. And weep with them that weep. If we're not careful, we'll find it easier to weep with those who weep than to rejoice with those who rejoice. Follow what I'm saying here. If things aren't going so well for you, and you look over and another brother seems to be doing well, if you're not careful, what will creep in? That green-eyed monster, envy. I like what Lee Robertson used to say, you can't be right with God if you can't rejoice in another brother's blessing. Envy. Envy will destroy. Who can stand before envy, the Bible says? You can't envy somebody else and love at the same time. You can't. Charity envieth not. Charity sees somebody else being blessed and rejoices. Notice next, charity vaunteth not itself, is not puffed up. In fact, just turn back. We're close to this passage. Look at 1 Corinthians 8. There were some arguments going on in the church at Corinth. And in 1 Corinthians 8, look at verses 1 through 3, they're talking about things offered unto idols. Some people were arguing, yeah, it's okay. Others were saying, no, you shouldn't do it. They're arguing amongst themselves as believers. Notice what he writes in 1 Corinthians 8, 1. He says, now as touching things offered unto idols, we know that we all have knowledge. We all have our point of view. We all have our facts that we base our beliefs on. But notice, does that mean knowledge is not important? No, knowledge is important. But it needs to be tempered with something. Notice, knowledge puffeth up, but charity does what? Edifieth. What's edifieth? Builds up. Charity puff, or rather, knowledge can puff me up if I'm not careful, but charity seeks to build someone else up with my knowledge. Verse 2, and if any man think that he knoweth anything, he knoweth nothing. Yet as he ought to know. Do we really know everything? Can we learn more? Yeah, we could. Verse 3, but if any man love God, the same is known of him. One of the characteristics of charity is that it vaunteth not itself, is not puffed up. It doesn't seek to exalt itself. It seeks to build up other people. You know, someone who tears other people down is fairly weak. A bully who picks on others is not a strong person. They're a weak person. They have a poor view of themselves, so they have to tear somebody else down. Look, charity is not puffed up. It vaunteth not itself, is not puffed up. Notice next, 1 Corinthians 13, verse 5, doth not behave itself unseemly. Charity, real love, is not unseemly. It's not indecent. It's not shameful. Let me say it this way. True love can wait. True love can. Young people, someone wants to go around your parents and get you to do things that are wrong and ungodly. That is not love. That is lust. That is sin. That person doesn't have your best interest at heart. Charity, notice, doth not behave itself unseemly. What else about charity? Charity seeketh not her own. Philippians 2:4 says, look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Charity's unselfish. It thinks of other people. Everything is not viewed through the lens of what do I want. Everything is viewed through the lens of how can this benefit others. Notice next how important this one is. Is not easily provoked. Now I want you to see it doesn't say is never provoked. There are some things that should provoke you. You know, Paul, he was provoked when he saw them given to idolatry. And there are certain things that ought to stir the fire. In fact, anybody who doesn't have a little passion is missing something. So it doesn't say is never provoked. Jesus went to the temple when they were exchanging money. They'd made God's house, instead of a house of prayer, they'd made it a den of thieves. What did he do? He went and made a whip. By the way, did Jesus lose control of himself? No, it took him time to make that whip. He was provoked. He went and started whipping people and said, be gone. In so many words. Started tipping over tables. Now, he only did that one time, but he could do it, and he did do it. He's provoked. So this doesn't say is never provoked, but what it does say, don't miss this, it says is not easily provoked. In other words, charity doesn't look for faults and reasons to be upset. If you really love somebody, you're not looking for a reason to be upset. Do you know, if you look at the most precious diamond, if you look close enough, what are you going to see inside that diamond? You're going to see flaws. You're going to see cracks and dark spots and things. And look, you may have in your family or in your spouse or in some person in your life, you may have a jewel. I mean, a jewel or a diamond. I mean, literally, you may have someone that is just a treasure, but you look closely at anybody, you're going to find faults. You look closely at anybody, you're going to find failures. By the way, how much more so than in the marriage relationship where you're two, you know, a son of Adam and a daughter of Eve living together from, you know, two separate cultures, you're going to notice flaws in one another. If you're not careful, you'll miss the treasure you have. The treasure you have. You know, I remember the parable Jesus told of the story about the treasure in the field. And a good illustration. A man went, he found treasure in the field. What did he do? He sold everything he had for that treasure. But what else was in the field? Some weeds, probably a skunk or two, some garbage, but there was a treasure. Be careful. Charity is not easily provoked. It's not looking for faults and reasons to be upset. By the way, if we are so focused on other people's faults, it's usually because we're ignoring our own. Remember what Jesus said. He said, judge not, that you be not judged. Now, if you keep reading, he's not telling you don't ever judge. And the word judge means to discern. He's not telling you don't ever judge. But what he is saying is this. If you read it in context, he's saying you'll be judged by the same standard you set for others. And then what did he say? He said, why beholdest thou the mote that is in thy brother's eye? What's a mote? It's like a little speck. You ever been cutting something, a little bit of sawdust gets in your eye? Irritates you. It's right there. It's irritating. Let me say this. If you notice a speck in somebody's eye, you're looking too closely. You're looking right here if you can see a speck in somebody's eye. He said, and you behold the mote that's in your brother's eye, the speck, and you consider not the beam. That's a 2x4. That is in thine own eye. Careful that you don't whack people in the head with your 2x4. If you're not careful, you'll be looking so close in other people's eyes for their mote, you'll hit them upside the head with your 2x4. Again, what is he saying? Is not easily provoked, isn't looking for faults, looking for reasons to be upset. You can find them. You want to be upset? You can be. I've told you this before when it came to church. Someone years ago, and I hate this, but I'll tell the story. They were gone. They left the church. And I asked them, you know, what was going on? And this is no joke. I'm not telling you this to make you nervous about this. I'm telling you this just to show you how silly people can get about things. They said, well, there were some pillows in the pews where I wanted to sit. Say, somebody actually said that. They actually said that. You know what that was? And you learn this. They were looking for a reason to be upset. If you want to find a reason, hey, you can list 10 right now. I mean, there's just, you can find a reason. You want a reason to be upset with your spouse? You can find a reason. You want a reason to be upset with somebody at church or at work? You can find a reason. But charity, notice, charity is not easily provoked. Notice next how important this one is. Charity thinketh no evil. Verse 5, thinketh no evil. What does that mean? It means give people the benefit of the doubt. Give people the benefit of the doubt rather than always assuming the worst. Always assuming the worst. Give people the benefit of the doubt. Hey, with your children, if you're trying, you know, if there are some things they're doing that aren't right, then yeah, it needs to be corrected. But it's a good thing also to catch them doing right. Don't always assume they're doing wrong. Now, as a parent, you know the things they're going to try. How do you know that? Kids wonder, how do they know that? Because you tried the same things. My parents are smart. They know that stuff, right? You tried the same things. But don't always assume that they're trying to do wrong. Maybe they have the right motive. Charity, notice, thinketh no evil. It gives people the benefit of the doubt rather than always assuming the worst. How many of you know what shadow boxing is? Shadow boxing. It's like what Paul said, beating the air. There's no real enemy there, but you're punching it anyway. Don't always assume the worst. How many of you have ever assumed something before and you're thankful you didn't speak on it because days later you realize your assumption was dead wrong? You know what will solve that? Give people the benefit of the doubt. Charity. That's what love does. That's what God's kind of love does. And then notice another characteristic of God's kind of love, charity. It rejoices in truth and not iniquity. Notice what it says, verse 6, rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in the truth. And that doesn't just mean your own iniquity. Yeah, of course, you shouldn't rejoice in iniquity yourself. But it also means this, it doesn't rejoice in somebody else's iniquity. What I'm talking about here is when somebody sins or does wrong, be careful that you don't start the gossip train. That you just enjoy the next juicy bit of gossip. Did you hear? Hey, everybody, let's pray for so-and-so. Did you hear what they did? That's not love. Galatians 6:1, in fact, it says, brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such an one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. Love doesn't rejoice in iniquity. It doesn't hear bad news about somebody else and rejoice and want to spread it to everybody as soon as possible. Proverbs 17:5 says it this way, he that is glad at calamities shall not be unpunished. True love doesn't enjoy gossiping about others' failures, but true love does enjoy talking about other people's triumphs. Hey, here's a challenge. Spend twice as much time telling everybody about what all the good things everybody else around you's been doing, instead of gossiping about the bad things that you heard them that they did. charity rejoices in truth and not iniquity. And then notice next, charity, verse 7, beareth all things, believeth all things. Now, that believeth all things doesn't mean it's gullible and just believes everything, but follow what this verse is saying. Beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. What it's saying is this: it doesn't give up on others. It doesn't give up. It's always hopeful for the one, the object of the love. It's like the prodigal son. When the prodigal son took off and he took his inheritance and he went into a far country and he wasted his substance with riotous living, there was still one person watching for him. Who was it? His father. What drove his father to watch for him? Charity. Beareth all things. Do you think his father had some sleepless nights? Some burdens? Thinking about his son? Of course he did, but he beareth all things, believeth all things. Others had given up on his son. He didn't give up on him. Hopeth all things. I remember how my son used to be. He's living foolishly in the world now, being destroyed, but I hope, I want to see him come back. Endureth all things. That's what charity does. The characteristics of charity: it's long-suffering and kind. It envieth not. It vaunteth not itself. It's not puffed up. It does not behave itself unseemly or indecently. It seeketh not her own. It's not easily provoked. It thinketh no evil. Rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in the truth. Beareth all things. Believeth all things. Hopeth all things. Endureth all things. That's what charity does. How many of you are glad God hasn't given up on you? My hand's up. Philippians 1:6, being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it unto the day of Jesus Christ. What keeps God bearing all things, believing all things, hoping all things, enduring all things? Look, yeah, I know one day we're going to be like Christ, but I'll tell you his motivation, it's love. His love, his great love wherewith he loves us. Number three, last of all, notice the endurance of charity. Verse 8, charity never faileth. But whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. All those gifts are important. The word of God obviously is important. He says, for we know in part and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away. Well, what's perfect that's come? The word of God. We have the perfect word of God. What else is perfect? We are going to be perfect. We're going to be made just like Jesus Christ. But notice what he says. Those other things, we prophesy in part. When that which is perfect is come, that which is in part shall be done away. Verse 11, when I was a child, I spake as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. When I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know even as also I am known. Verse 13, and now abideth what? Faith, hope, charity. Is faith important? Oh, it's absolutely important. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. But without charity, even if you have all faith that can remove mountains, we're nothing. Hope, is hope important? By the way, when the Bible uses the word hope, it doesn't mean you're crossing your fingers saying, boy, I hope this works. It means you're expecting God to fulfill his word. It's a hope. When we say we have a blessed hope, it doesn't mean, well, I hope Jesus comes back. It means we know he's coming back. Amen. We're looking forward to it. We're anticipating. We're expecting it. That's what hope means in the Bible. But notice what he says. Now abideth, right now, faith, hope, charity. But there's a greatest of those. And what is it? But the greatest of these is what? Charity. Why? Because in heaven, will you need faith? In heaven, it'll be by sight. We're going to see him face to face. We're going to see him. In heaven, will we need hope? Well, boy, I hope one day. No, it will be there. We'll be experiencing it. But I'll tell you what will be there for all eternity. Charity. God's perfect, pure love. When we see the wounds, not the scars, the wounds in Jesus' hands, and when we see the wounds in his feet, we're going to be reminded that we are loved. that we are loved so much that the Heavenly Father sent His only begotten Son to this world so that we could live through Him. Charity will endure for all eternity. And in order for us right now, in the here and now, to be effectively used by God, we must have a fervent love, charity for God and for man. How do we show our love for God? Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. We obey him. How do we show our love for man? We show our love for man by loving others the way God has loved us. How did God love us? 1 John says, we love him because he first loved us. You know, to transform your relationships, you be the first to love. You can't control what somebody else does towards you, but you can control whether you love others. Let's bow our heads together, please. Without charity, we're nothing. Even with sacrifice, even with spiritual gifts, we're nothing. We accomplish nothing. We have all knowledge, all faith. We understand all mysteries, but have not charity. We've missed the point. Knowledge puffeth up, but charity edifieth. See, charity is always others focused. It's always looking to how can I be a blessing, a help to somebody else. That'll transform a marriage. That'll transform a home. That'll transform a church. That'll transform your soul winning. You get the focus off yourself and on that lost soul. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Would you let the Holy Ghost of God inspect your heart tonight? Like the candle of the Lord, the Bible says, searching all the innermost parts of the belly. Will you let the Holy Spirit of God search every part of your heart and show to you if you need to be more like Christ in this matter of charity? Charity never faileth. It's a more excellent way. It's a more excellent way. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Who would say tonight, Pastor, if I died today, I know I'd go to heaven. I know I'm loved. I know I'm saved. Jesus paid the price for me. I know I'm saved. And I want to thank him. If that's you, would you lift your hand? Would you praise him? You're accepted. We're accepted in the beloved. That I, a child of hell, should in his image shine. What an amazing thing. We're loved. We're accepted in the beloved. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Is there anyone who'd say, Pastor, if I died today, I don't know I'd go to heaven. I'm not 100% sure. Pray for me, please. If that's you, lift your hand. With our heads still bowed and our eyes still closed. Knowledge is important. Faith is important. Hope, all those things, those are important. But there's a greatest of these. There's something that never faileth. What is it? It's charity. It's the pinnacle of spiritual maturity. When we love like Christ, we'll be like Christ. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. How is your love for the Lord? How do we show our love for the Lord? Through our obedience. How do we show our love for man? By loving them the way Christ loved us, by loving them first. Someone's done you wrong. You're waiting for them to make things right. Why don't you love them first? Now, you can't control what they do. You can't control how they'll respond. But you can control. You can control how you in your heart respond to them. You can control whether you love them. With our heads bowed and eyes closed, who would say to the Lord, Dear Lord, help me to be more like you. Help me to love the way you do. Please, Lord, love others through me. Love others through me. If that's you, would you lift your hand to the Lord? Without charity, we can do nothing. Without charity, we are nothing, and it profiteth nothing, rather. Let the Lord love others through you. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. Bless it to our hearts. Help us to remember and meditate upon the things we've heard tonight. Help us to examine our own lives, our own attitudes towards other people and towards you. And help us to love as you have loved. Please give us a greater capacity to love as you have. Bless as we go our separate ways tonight. Put ahead.